The EYRES Action Sports Games is one of Asia Pacific's leading action sports competitions. The games feature over 150 world-class athletes from 24 countries competing in a series of exciting sports, all staged in the picturesque city of Mandurah in Western Australia. The event features rounds of the International Water Ski and Wakeboard Federation World Cup with $300,000 in prize money on offer. Apart from the water activities, the games also feature leading skate and BMX athletes in action, together with a spectacular freestyle motocross team, and let's not forget the glamour from the Miss Action Sports Games competition. Located less than an hour from Perth, the coastal city of Mandurah in Western Australia's pristine southwest region is renowned for its stunning waterways, pristine environment, great food and wine, and of course, its relaxed outdoor lifestyle. With its warm hospitality and idyllic riverside setting, Mandurah is the ideal venue for this world-class sporting event. Athletes from all over the world will battle it out for 3 days for individual honors and the right to be crowned the EYRES Action Sports Champion. Coming up in the program, we'll feature the Wakeboard World Cup Finals in both men's and women's, the Ski Jump Final in men's and women's, and the Trick Ski. We'll also showcase highlights from the skate and BMX competitions, plus all the high-flying antics from the freestyle motocross. For the athletes, Mandurah is a special part of the world, and they love coming here to perform and to mix with so many other athletes from so many countries. The wakeboarders especially rate Mandurah as one of their favorite competition venues.
I love Mandurah. This is probably one of my favorite World Cup stops, just because the atmosphere, the way, you know, everyone puts on the tournament, it's so professional, and I just love coming here.
Yeah, Mandurah's beautiful. I love coming over here. I got a bunch of friends over here. It's sick. Like, this estuary, I guess, runs straight through the middle of the town here, and it's a fun place.
It's pretty cool. Like, you got the skateboarding, you got the motorbike riding, you've got the wakeboarding, the trick skiing, jump. So it's a pretty big event, and Sunday will be lots of people. So hopefully I don't get too shy in front of the crowd.
I remember last year there was a huge crowd that came out, which is always an amazing bonus as well. And there's so many activities around as well as the wakeboarding, which is really, really good. We saw some dolphins as well, actually, that were just swimming right beside us while we were going, and that's cool.
The men's wake is a star-studded field with many of the biggest names in the sport on show, including American Daniel Powers, Japan's Shota Tezuka, the Dutchman Mark Kroon, and U.S. Tour veteran Andrew Adkisson. But everyone will be out to stop the reigning king of wake and world number one, Harley Clifford from Australia. We now join the action in the semifinals with 12 riders competing in 3 4-man heats. The last 2 competitors from each heat will be eliminated, with the final 6 progressing to the all-important final. First up in heat 1, it was U.S. sensation Daniel Powers, looking to get off to a good start.
And a glorious day in Mandurah takes us into the men's semi-finals. This is Wakeboard, and Daniel Powers from the USA opens with a pretty good looking 360. Now the guys need to get plenty of air to impress the judges, and also difficulty of tricks also counts to who's going to make it through to the final round. So back on his second pass, ollies up onto the rail, nice work there from Daniel, pops to the heel side. good-looking tantrum with a switch landing, nearly falls, but he makes it through. Well, the pressure's on now. The board just bumping around, slightly testing conditions, but the guys will be going really aggressive, and that's a fantastic closing trick there for Daniel Powers. Oh, he's got one more as he heads down to the end of his run. And great stuff there, Daniel Powers.
Last up in Heat 4, it was Shota Tezuka from Japan, who only needed a score of 46 points or more to move into the final.
Well, here's a guy that gets really technical, and he also goes big too. Shota Tezuka opens with a KGB, and that's pretty good looking stuff there. From Shota, switches to the heel side. That's a 540, delightfully clean too for Shota Tezuka. Well, he really needs to put down some pretty good scores to make it through to the final. He'd love to compete against Harley Clifford. And Harley hasn't made it through, don't forget, just as yet, but they're training partners in Orlando, Florida. So Shota Tezuka, the new guy on the block, putting down a great opening pass. Now coming back from the bridge end, pops it up onto the rail, 360 on the flat bar. Great stuff there for Shota. Now he comes in heelside. Nice and big, as is customary for the young man from Japan, really stomping it down here in the first of three semi-finals. So it's going to be tight to see who can make it through. And Shota Tezuka really stamping down. Oh, what a flying finish there for Shota. Has he got time to fit one more in? Edges in hard, testing conditions, and just falls right on the bell. But great score for Shota Tezuka.
Despite a late fall, Shota did more than enough to take Heat 1, moving into the final with a score of 72.34. Daniel Powers was also impressive in second, with a score of 66.47. Next on the water, it was Parker Siegel from Australia.
Parker Siegel from Australia opens with a great-looking trick and now backs it up with a heel side three. Very clean. Now he's calling for more speed there, is Parker Siegel, as he edges in heelside. That's a big whirly bird he's just thrown there, just landed on the top of the wake, but handled it no problems whatsoever, did Parker Siegel. Throws forward into a dum-dum, just lands on the top of the wake. That's a toe side roll with a backside 360 handle pass. So he's really getting technical now, is Parker Siegel, and he looks so neat and comfortable as he lands. Great style, and I tell you what, the judges will be absolutely noticing Parker Siegel out there in this men's semi-final. Number two slides off the rail. Now, oh, great looking seven. Look at the speed that he spins the board. Now Parker Siegel edging in on his toe side. And that's a chromo, so he's really piling on the points here. Now, what can he do this time? Coming in heel side. A great tantrum, because that's huge air and the judges will really be noticing that. Now toe side, edges in very aggressively. This is going to be plenty of spins and a 720 to wrap things up. Great stuff, Parker Siegel.
The American Andrew Adkisson was the last to hit the water in Heat 2.
And opening with a big whirly bird, AA, the All-American Andrew Adkisson. Well, he really needs to put on a pretty good showing here this afternoon, because he needs to make it through to the final. Many times has he competed on the World Cup. He's a veteran of the World Cup. He's one of the finest wakeboarders in the world, though, and Andrew Adkisson, he really knows what to do when the pressure is on. Edges in heelside. Some pretty big tricks to finish off his opening pass. That, no doubt, will impress the judges as he squeezes one last trick in just before the bridge. Well, he'll be back for pass number two, and the pressure now is on for Andrew Adkisson. Great work off the flat bar, looking really good as he edges in heelside, and a big chromo, so he's putting on plenty of points here. Definitely impressing the judges, I would think. So switches now to the heelside, edging in very aggressively. That's a heelside five. Great technical points from the American here, Andrew Adkisson, this afternoon with a bat wing. Well, can he ride his way through to the final? He dearly would love to do so. And a great stand-up pass too for the American.
So it was the local boy, Parker Siegel from Australia, taking Heat 2 with a solid score of 68.79 and moving into the final with Adkisson also sneaking through in 67.79. Heat 3 started with a Flying Dutchman, Mark Kroon.
Heat 3 of 3, the top two of each go through. And Mark Kroon, toe side 5 there. Well, he knows he's going to have to do plenty if he can make it through. edges in very aggressively on the heel side. That's a Moby Dick putting on some very technical tricks here. Water's just a little bit bouncy, but no problem there as he lands a dum-dum. That's a front roll with a spin and a handle pass. So really getting it done out here this afternoon as he just finishes his second pass. And you can see the form in slow-mo. This guy really knows how to ride. Second pass. Starting to really go big there. That's a big 720 just to open the second pass now as Mark Kroon from the Netherlands. He really needs to pile on the points. Well, he just came up a little bit short, landed on the top of the wake, but had no problem riding it out. But maybe he'll be marked down a little by the judges. There's a big whirly bird five, but unfortunately eats it on the top of the wake.
The last rider in the semi-final round was number one seed Harley Clifford from Australia.
Well, here's a guy who really knows how to ride, but he's calling for more boat speed. Well, I hope this isn't going to unsettle Harley Clifford. Edges in on the toe side. Very difficult tricks now he's starting to put out. But that is always the case with Harley Clifford as he pulls off a big Moby Dick there. Just lands on the top of the wake, but always looking comfortable. Just like he was born on a wakeboard is Harley Clifford from Australia. And switches to the heel side. So Harley Clifford wanting to pile on the points here and impress the judges. Well, he's seen what the earlier guys have done. He knows exactly what to beat. And that's some extremely fast spinning there. A heel side seven there, Harley Clifford. Oh, and the maestro, a toe side nine. Great looking stuff there for Harley, edging in now. This is going to really impress the judges, and he catches the top of the wake and unfortunately falls. Well, Harley Clifford will have to wait to see if he can make it through to the final round.
So with the highest score of the day, 79.45, Heat 3 went to Harley Clifford, with Mark Kroon also moving into the final six with a score of 66.91. The final promises to be a great showdown between the heavyweights of World Wake. It's no wonder Harley Clifford has moved so effortlessly into the final. In recent years, he's taken the world of wake by storm, and at just 19 years of age, he continues to set the standard, pushing the sport to new limits. And no one recognizes this more than wake legend Andrew Adkisson.
Yeah, ranked number one in the world. I won the world championships last year and then the King of Wake, which is sort of like our overall tour title. So there's a little bit more pressure, you know, I just go out there and try and have fun, and whatever happens, happens. If I don't win, then it's not my day.
Harley's the best rider the sport's ever seen. I mean, you could combine any two, three riders' tricks, and he has them still covered up on tricks, not only with what he can do, but the consistency of those as well. What he's bringing to the sport is just something you have to respect, and it pushes everybody.
Right, I feel like a lot of people go into the contest and they put so much pressure on themselves, and then they fall and they're just like, oh. But I just go in and whatever happens, happens. If I win, I'm stoked. If I don't win, I'm still stoked. I'm still at wakeboarding.
You know, I think Harley's laid-back approach definitely does help, you know. But, I mean, when it comes down to the tournament day, he's laid back and enjoying it. You know, he doesn't get too anxious, but he has his game face on. You know, he knows when it's showtime and when it's time to step it up, bring it to the table, and he always does.
I do like a lot of tricks that people don't do. Like, invented a lot of my own tricks, and I do those in the contest, and they're tricks that nobody else can do. So that's sort of, I guess, my high point, like being able to do, the judges look at me and they're like, he did like four tricks that no one else can even do. So I guess that's pretty easy. And then I grab a lot of my tricks. A lot of people don't grab so much of their stuff. So I just try and like work on grabbing everything and going a little bit bigger than everyone else and smiling.
To try to pick one thing that sets Harley apart from other wakeboarders is just trying to put it in too small of a box. I mean, his ability on rails, his ability behind the boat, his ability on cable, but just the versatility of his tricks, there's no gaps in his riding.
There's so many kids coming through now, like that Marcy kid from Italy and Tony Iconi from Australia, and then Shota Tezuka, the Japanese guy, and then Andrew, he's like a two-time world champion in the past, so he's a veteran, and he can watch everyone ride and know exactly what he has to do to get on the podium, so he's always a tough one.
When you enter a competition, it's for a reason, to go out there and do your best, you know, and put everything out there that you can. And absolutely, I've taken quite a few seconds to Harley, and a few of those seconds there was a big gap, and a few of those other ones it was a closer gap. But I mean, Harley's really dominating the pack, and you have more guys jumping in there, like Shota Tezuka, Daniel Powers, all the Mastercraft riders. I mean, it's just, it's a pretty thin margin between first and last out here right now.
While the Wake athletes were mixing it up in the water, the freestyle motocross boys were warming to the task with a spectacular freestyle exhibition, much to the delight of the huge Mandurah crowd. One of the great attractions of the Action Sports Games that so many athletes from so many different disciplines can come together in one place and put on a show, offering a little bit of something for everyone. Spurred on by an appreciative crowd, the riders soon lifted the tempo with a series of spectacular jumps. While the riders make it look easy, there's no room for error, and it's a sport where you always have to be on your guard. It takes great skill and discipline, not to mention plenty of nerve. We now go from one flying sport to another, with the final of the women's ski jump. Eight girls make their way into the final, where they'll each get three attempts to maximize their jump distance. This is a tough sport, and not for the faint-hearted. First up in the final, it was Danielle Bennett from the U.S. Second on the track was Nancy Chardon from France. Her best jump was 36.4, which moved her into the lead. Up next, it was Marie Vimpernasova from Greece. With a jump of 40.5 meters, she pushed Chardon back to second. The jumps continued to lengthen, with Alex Loretano from the U.S. reaching 42.3 meters. Next up, it was Lauren Morgan from the U.S., clearing 43.5 and giving her a temporary lead, with just three jumpers to come. Marion Mathieu, another French girl, just pipped Morgan to take the lead, with a score of 43.7 meters. The competition couldn't get any tighter, with barely a meter now separating first, second, and third. Judah Lamy from Finland was next, and she recorded a best jump of 43 meters, moving her into third position overall, with just one more jump to come. Last up, it was Jacinta Carroll from Australia, who needed to beat 43.7 meters to take the title. With the hometown crowd willing her on, she delivered as required, landing a spectacular jump of 46.3 meters to take the EYRES Action Sports Games women's ski jump title. And so, in the end, it was a strong win to Jacinta Carroll, taking the crown almost 3 meters ahead of Marion Mathieu in second, with Lauren Morgan from the U.S. in third, and Lamy from Finland in fourth.
It's great to bring home a World Cup win, obviously, in my home country. It definitely means a lot.
The action never ends in Mandurah as we now head back to the waterfront to join the six-man final of the Open Men's Trick Ski. Trick skiing is a highly technical sport that takes great skill and precision. First up in the final, it was Alexei Zarnasek. Taking full advantage of the smooth early conditions, he got off to a great start, setting the pace with a strong score of 10,010. Second on the track was the Czech competitor. After a few hiccups, he finished with a disappointing score of 8,710 and well off the pace. Third up, it was Jimmy Seemers from the USA. A sharp, consistent performance, Seemers moved into the lead with a strong score of 10,140. Pierre Ballon from France was next on the water. Knowing he had a big score to chase, he pushed too hard, and following a series of falls, he finished well back with a score of 6,150. The second last rider was Australia's own Joshua Bryant, with a solid all-round routine. He finished with a score of 9,650, pushing into third position overall. The last rider was the second Frenchman, Alexandre Pateau, who needed to better 10,140 to take the title. It wasn't to be, with Pateau finishing in fifth place overall with a score of 8,460. So in the end, the men's trick ski final went to the American champion, Jimmy Seemers, winning by 130 points over Alexei Zarnasek from Belarus, with the Australian Joshua Bryant taking third. The women's wake final is another world-class field with six contenders from six different countries. Defending champion and former IWWF World Wakeboard Champion Rainey Merritt from the US will be the one to beat. She's won everything in her career, and she's driven by a love of the sport and a thirst for more success.
I grew up water skiing because my dad was a professional barefoot water skier, so he kind of introduced me to wakeboarding, and kind of ever since he introduced me, I love the sport. I love being out on the water, and I've always had like this drive to want to, you know, get every title and, you know, win it more than once. So coming here trying to win my eighth World Cup title, you know, it's just kind of a drive that I have. I love the sport just because it's fun. I love the water. I love being able to, you know, learn new tricks, you know, going big in the air, and just everybody in the sport. I mean, you get great friends, and it's just fun to be able to go out on the boat for a living instead of having to sit in an office.
Merritt sees Australia's Bec Gange as one of her biggest threats here in Mandurah.
Women's wakeboarding is incredible now. Like, everyone's doing at least a tech trick in the past. I think we just realized that we can ride as good as the guys can. Like, there's so many more girls that are stepping up and doing bigger tricks. So, and other girls are seeing that and realize that, yeah, we can actually do it too. So yeah, and it's just getting much more competitive these days.
I think my biggest threat this weekend is probably going to be Nicola Butler and Bec Gange. You know, the last couple stops they've been, you know, on top, and going into the final, it's always a little bit extra pressure, just because I want to, you know, not only stand up my pass, but I want to, you know, grab the title. So it's definitely a little bit of pressure, but you know, I feel very confident, and I've been practicing in a little bit rougher water just because I know, you know, the conditions here, but I'm really excited.
So first up in the women's final, it was Robbie Rendo leading the way from Argentina.
So first competitor in the women's final, Robbie Rendo. Well, it's a seeded order, so as we work through, we'll be finishing with our top seed. So Robbie Rendo is going to lay down some sort of a platform here. She would hope edges in. That's a back roll. The conditions look a little better than the semi-finals, so the girls will be really looking for some big scores. And just jumping across the wake there, maybe just getting settled into the conditions. But it's the finals, though, so the girls can't leave anything to chance here, and a front roll there just to finish things as she goes under the bridge now. Back on her second pass, pops up onto the rail. Good points there for Robbie. Just starts to, well, she's crossing the wake. I'm not sure what, I guess positioning herself, not comfortable on the other side of the wake, but she's really going to have to get a move on here and gets into what I would call a lean lock and buries herself into the wake. Bad luck for Robbie Rendo there and a nasty fall.
China's Chen Lili was next out on the track.
Well, Chen Lili, oh, and she's landed short on the top of the wake, popped the handle and fallen. Well, bad luck for Chen Lili. She's just finished seeing Robbie Rendo have a disappointing run, and Chen Lili just couldn't back it up and improve. Well, see what she can do now. An aggressive edge in. That's an air Rayleigh. But there's plenty more to come. She edges in toe side. That's a scarecrow. Pops off the top of the wake and really wanting to make amends and put on some big points here is Chen Lili as we see that scarecrow in slow-mo just bounced off the top of the wake. Now into the second pass. Well, uncomfortably booted off the wake, loses the handle, and a disappointing score for Chen Lili.
The third rider was Nick Butler from Great Britain. With two low opening scores, the competition remained wide open.
Well, the first couple of competitors having a little bit of a problem with the conditions, and as Nicola Butler calling for a little bit more speed, she opened with a half cab 180. She's going to have to get a little more technical and maybe try and get more air as well to impress the judges, because she wants to take out this event. She's been a many-time winner on the US Pro Tour, so she comes in with lots of experience. Well, she tried to ollie onto the rail there and nearly missed out, but slid up the ramp there and got away with it in the end. So Nicola Butler, glad to stand up the first pass. Let's see what she can do on the second. Now she edges in heel side. That's a tantrum. Gets good air, so that means she'll be putting on a pretty good score. But she's got to stand up the rest of the pass, can Nicola Butler. That was good-looking stuff. Well, she settles herself down. Now she just waits for the ideal position. Edges in, and that's a 360. Well, not very difficult, but still handling the conditions a little bit better than the earlier girls.
Beck Gange was the next into the water and keen to show her best on home soil.
So Beck Gange on home soil in Australia. Good-looking back roll just to start things off. Just to settle herself down, I would think. Starts to edge in on her toe side. That's a scarecrow. So it's a front roll with a 180. So Beck just settling down once again, as I said. Looking to handle the conditions better than the earlier girls. That's a 360 there as she starts to head out of the course. Has she got time for one more trick? Beck Gange from Mildurah, Australia. And just pops across the wake, pulls off a 180. And I think she's going to have to get a little more technical if she's going to take out this event. But she has one full pass to go. Now, this is going to count for some points. Slides up onto the rail. Just leans forward on the board there. So that's going to give us some extra bonus points from the judges as she edges in heel side. That's a whirly bird, and she pulls it off. Just landed on the top of the wake there, but managed to maintain her composure. So great stuff there, Beck Gaines from Australia. Really the hopes on the shoulders of this girl here. As that's a tootsie roll. Now she's starting to get into business and pops to the heel side. Edges in very aggressively. That's a tantrum, and that's a great second pass by Beck Gaines.
With Beck Gange now well out in front, the last rider was Caroline from Sweden.
And Caroline unfortunately falling on that opening trick. Well, I'm not sure exactly what she was attempting. She got so out of control, either a tantrum or maybe even a whirly. But back on deck now, comes in with a scarecrow. So that's a front roll with a 180 turn, and now edging it on a heel side for a back roll. So Caroline settling herself down now, handling the conditions very well, but not electing to try and squeeze any more tricks in before the bridge. Well, I thought she could have fitted an extra one in, but that wasn't the case. Nice work on the flat bar, though. And now Caroline pops to the back. So now she's heel side. That's a tantrum, and a big tantrum too. Good air too. That's part of the judging criteria, so that's good to see. Edges in now on her toe side. That's a front roll. Now, has she got time to squeeze another trick in? Yes, plenty of room at the bottom end here at Mandurah. And that's a 360. Well, she's got plenty of time left, I would think. Now, edging on a toe side. These are valuable points for Caroline. And that's a 540. And that's a great pass, too, from Caroline.
And finally, it was the number one seed and event favorite, Raimi Merritt, who entered the fray, looking to secure yet another World Cup title.
Well, women's final, Raimi Merritt, the defending champion. Let's see what she can do. Just adjust the helmet there. She wants to be comfortable. Big S-bend. Oh, and she came up way short, and that's a hard fall there. Raimi Merritt, well, I hope she's okay to continue because, oh, she's really eaten it big time there on an S-bend. Well, a big opening trick, but she gets things back together. Now hits the rail, but gee, the pressure's on if she's going to take out this event because there's some pretty good scores on the board, I would think, so far. That's a toe side five for the American, a many times winner on the World Cup. Sets herself up now, aggressively in, and that's that S-bend that she fell on earlier, but she manages to pull it off. Well, she's certainly a game young lady, is Raimi Merritt, and that's why she is such a champion. Oh, and just bottoms out on that, I think, attempted bat wing and couldn't ride it out. And as we go to replay on that difficult S-bend, well, no problems there, but I don't know if she's done enough to take out this event.
It was Australia's Beck Gange who stole the title with a dominant display in front of her home crowd. A clear 12 points clear of her nearest rival, Nicola Butler, in second. For Raimi Merritt, it was a disappointing performance given her own high standards.
It's pretty incredible. Obviously, I didn't ride too good yesterday or the day before, but yeah, managed to pull it off today, so pretty happy.
The EYRES Action Sports Games also hosted a national skate and BMX competition with over $20,000 in prize money up for grabs. Some of Australia's best went head-to-head in a great display of freestyle riding.
Today's competition is about BMX, so we have the BMX Pro competition rolling today. Tomorrow's Skateboard Pro. We have a good line of riders from around Australia. Guys are just hitting up amazing tricks and just getting totally loose. It's pretty crazy to see some of the lines the guys are hitting up. The guys have had 2 60-second runs. They're judged on points of difficulty, diversity, and consistency. And the top six will go into a qualifying round with the same format. We'll run again, and then from that we work out the top three that go into the finals. And we take into account all different kind of riding styles. Guys that are big on the flips and the whips, as opposed to guys that are big on the technical, like doing lots of rails and things like that, and transfers and different lines. So that therefore a competitor has to be more diverse. The more diverse you are in your riding and the more difficult you are, then obviously, you know, you're going to gain more points. It's a pretty good title to win. You're getting good bragging rights for one. From a rider's point of view, the amount of money you can win in this competition, there's nothing on par with that in Australia. The whole Action Sports Games is just super good.
We now head back to the river for the final of the spectacular men's ski jump. The final will feature three Americans, two British competitors, and a Canadian. The competitors will get three jumps with the highest score standing. First to take the ramp is Stephen Critchley from Great Britain. Critchley showed good form off the ramp and gradually improved his distance with each jump. After two conservative jumps, he saved his best to last. His final jump reached a distance of 57.1 meters. And with five more jumpers to come, he set the early pace. Second on the water was Jimmy Seemers from the USA. He gets off to a bad start. With too much speed, he hits the edge of the ramp, and with his weight too far back, it's an awkward landing. He recovers well and returns for the final attempt. Despite a rough landing, he manages a respectable distance of 53.1 meters and moves into second place. Next up, it's Scott Ellis from the US. His first jump is smooth, with plenty of air, but it's not enough, and he's determined to go one better. On the final attempt, he goes for more speed, and despite a heavy landing, it's a solid score of 57.4 meters, moving him into the overall lead. Fourth on the water, it's Damien Sharman from Great Britain. It's an awkward first jump, with his ski lifting sharply, and it's not the jump he was looking for. Jump two is also difficult as he pushes the edge of the ramp and is taken well off course. He somehow gains control, brings it around, and parks the landing. With his confidence now well and truly frayed, the final jump is a complete disaster. Trying to make up for a slow start, he pushes too hard and is sent tumbling forward, losing complete control and crashing heavily. But apart from having the wind knocked out of him, it's nothing more than a bruised ego. It's a 40-meter fall from grace that he will never forget, and neither will the appreciative crowd. In contrast to Damien Sharman, Ryan Dodd from Canada gets off to an impressive start with a powerful opening jump of 59.7 meters, which takes him into the overall lead. Desperate to build on the lead, he pushes hard and is bitterly disappointed at missing the final attempt after pulling out of a late whip. Freddy Krueger, the last jumper, is the best in the business, and it's going to take a special jump to beat him. With the confidence of a seasoned world champion and a name to match, Freddy Krueger stepped up to the plate and delivered in emphatic style, soaring 62.2 meters on his first attempt to take the EYRES Action Sports Jump title. There was no need for a second jump, with Krueger more than happy to rest on his laurels. So in the end, it was Krueger first, Dodd impressive in second, with a distance of 59.7 meters, and Ellis in third.
I'm very pleased. That was, we knew coming in the conditions were better this year, and I figured it was going to take a 60-meter jump to win it. Honestly, that was a great jump. I mean, I had great timing to the bottom. I got all my lift, and that wind swung around a little bit more to the southwest and just got up on it. So I'll remember that one for a long time.
It's now time for the men's wake final, with six of the world's best in contention, including Parker Siegel, Mark Kroon, the two Americans, Powers and Adkisson, and world number one, Harley Clifford. Japan's rising star Shota Tezuka is in ominous form, and he presents a real threat to Clifford and co. in the final. Shota's clearly a rider on the move, with his aggressive aerial displays attracting plenty of attention.
In Japan's wakeboard are getting bigger, but it's not that huge like America. I ride in America. I just started like 2 years ago, ride for the juniors, and I just won the junior step up pro for last year. And then I get third for the overall, so I'm pretty pumped on that. The older rider is really good, you know, they're training really hard for a whole year. Like Harley, Andrew, and Daniel Powers, you know, like David, and all those guys really good. And then Tony Iacone and Massey, those like rookies just come up, so it's gonna be a tough weekend.
First to hit the water in the final was Mark Kroon from the Netherlands.
Now to the men's wakeboard finals. Six guys, the top competitors, have made it through, and we see Mark Kroon from the Netherlands. That's a toe side five. So he's going to have to put on a great performance here if he can take out this final. Mandurah 2013, that was a Moby Dick. Comes in toe side, looking very big and very technical. Well, he just butts checks that one just a little, but now he's onto the slider and over to the side of the rail there, unfortunately. Well, that could be costly. Well, he really had a problem with the ollieing on to the rail. So it looks like he's going to have a second go at it. Second pass coming in. Mark Croon eyeing off that rail. Oh, this time no problem whatsoever. Switches that board around. Edges in toe side. That's a bat wing. So that's going to be some pretty good points because it's good for these guys from a judge's perspective to mix it up between spins and flips. And that's a great looking toe side. Nine there from Mark Croon. Well, this guy is really stamping down a big score, but unfortunately fell just towards the end of his run. So bad luck there for Mark Croon.
Next up, it was Daniel Powers from the US with a score of 53 to beat.
One of two Americans in this final. Opens with a hillside five. Most importantly, though, he got huge air, so that's going to really impress the judges. That's a roll to blind there. Is the board just rolling around a little bit backwashy here this afternoon. But so far, no problem there, and a great scarecrow there. That's a toe side front roll with a handle pass. So Daniel Powers absolutely adapting to the conditions beautifully in this men's final here this afternoon, and just tops it off by a great rail slide. And a bird's eye view of the form of Daniel Powers there on his first pass. Now we pick him up. Pass number two. Back onto the rail. Ollie's on beautifully. Just edging in now strongly. That's an Indy tantrum there for Dan Powers. What can he do on the next? Toe side. He's going to edge in extremely aggressively. And a toe side seven. Big points there. And he got a little strain on the rope at the end, but no problem in riding that one out. So Daniel Powers, he's really getting big, and he's getting technical, and he's putting an extremely big score on the board. Oh, great stuff from Dan Powers from the USA. And as a Mastercraft towboat is down at the bottom end of the course, he squeezes in that last trick. Oh, that was great work there from Dan the man. Well, he's got his wild card trick to come, and here it is, a big toe side seven. Look at the speed of the spin. Great stuff there from Daniel Powers.
Andrew Adkisson was disappointed with his semi-final performance and was looking to make amends in the final.
Well, I think it's fair to say one of our most experienced campaigners here, Andrew Adkisson from the USA. Well, he started fairly aggressively. I don't think he got a lot of air on that last trick, so he's going to have to pick up the pace as far as the aggression of how he edges into the wake. So he comes in toe side. That's a big toe side seven there. Very clean always is Andrew, so that's the mark of his performance. Just adjusts his helmet, wants to be nice and comfortable. And a big whirly bird, and as clean as you like there, Andrew Adkisson piling on the points when it really counts. Well, Andrew Adkisson knows that he only has one pass to go. Can this take him through to a win in the World Cup? Mandurah 2013. Good looking work off the rail. Edges in, hillside. That's a hillside 540. So he's going to have to probably raise the technicality, I guess you could say. And that's a Mob 5 from Andrew. Well, he's done exactly that. So when the pressure is on, this guy really knows how to deliver. But what can he do towards the end of his run? And he nearly goes out the front of that board, but that was huge air that he got. That's going to impress the judges, no doubt. A Tootsie Roll pulls up short and unfortunately falls. Well, he would dearly have loved to have ridden that trick out, but it wasn't to be the case. Now we pick up Andrew for his wild card trick. Oh, this is huge air. Oh, the big 313, and he unfortunately falls. Well, what an effort, as it's an air rally with a 360 spin, but it wasn't to be.
With Daniel Powers now in the lead, Parker Siegel needed a score of 75 or more to make an impression on the podium.
So the second of our two American competitors, Parker Siegel, on the water now. Well, this guy would dearly love to win the World Cup, and what a beautiful looking whirly bird there. Stands it up, no problem whatsoever. Comes in now with a Tootsie Roll. goes pretty big too, but I think he's going to need to go a little bigger if he's going to have to take out this crown. Well, there's a Moby Dick. Well, he's really starting to turn it on, but unfortunately falling there. So bad luck there for Parker Siegel. It was such a big trick. He really needed that one to go on the scorecard. Well, back on pass number two. Eyes off that rail. Slides along nicely, does Parker Siegel. Edges in on the hillside. Hillside seven. Oh, he's so neat, is Parker Siegel. Now toe side. He's getting very aggressive. And oh, great looking stuff there. He's as clean as you like, and the judges will really note this. And Parker Siegel, oh, that's a tantrum to blind. And the guy is on fire here this afternoon. Maybe not as technical as some of the others, but so clean. And Parker Siegel, a second stand-up pass. You can see the form and how much in control he is of that board, Parker Siegel. Now coming in on his wild card trick and unfortunately falling. Well, it's going to be a little bit costly for Parker, but looking good nonetheless on those earlier two passes.
Up next, it was Japan's Shota Tezuka, promising to hold nothing back in an effort to take the title.
So Shota Tezuka, second top seed, and he trains with Harley Clifford in Orlando, Florida, and Harley is our top seed. So a couple of friends here this afternoon really fighting it out for first place. Let's see if Shota can put together a couple of stand-up passes. He's known for going huge. He gets great air. And that's a big old whirly bird too, and he's landed well clear of the wake there. So big points there for Shota, and hits the rail on the way out. Well, that stand-up pass number one, he had a couple of glitches, but he would have put some good points together. And I think we're watching one of the glitches now. Gets all crossed up in the air, but quickly gets back together. So Shota, will he hit the rail a second time? Looks like he does. Really wanted to impress the judges here this afternoon. Watch out for that pole Shota. Okay, comes in. Well, he's really spinning big time here this afternoon. That was a hillside seven. And now, oh, now a big 900 from Shota Tezuka. Well, he's leaving nothing out on the water. The youngster from Japan is really flying here this afternoon in the men's wakeboard final here in World Cup 2017. He's really setting the waterways at Mandurah on absolute fire. When the score comes to hand for Shota, believe you me, it is going to be big. Now we still need to see his wild card trick, which could pick him up even a few more points. Edges in so strongly and aggressively. Huge air and goes for a whirly five. And oh, that would have been a fantastic bonus, but bad luck there for Shota Tezuka.
With a brilliant score of 84, Shota sets the mark. And with the pressure on, Clifford knows he has to come up with something special to hold off Shota.
So coming into course, and Harley Clifford was just tweaking the boat speed. Now remember, folks, this is a guy who's undefeated in World Cup stops. Edges in strongly on the toe side, and Harley Clifford really starting to want to impress the judges now. Aggressively on the heel side. That's a big Moby Dick. Great stuff there from Harley. Okay, eyeing off the conditions. Now a 540 spin. Just making sure he lays a platform now. Is the defending champion, and Harley looking good on a roll to blind and pretty happy with that opening stand-up pass. But I really think, looking at the score of Shota Tezuka, Harley Clifford's going to have to move things up a notch in the second pass. Well, let's see what he can do. Slides off the rail, ollies on nicely, plenty of control there. Jumps around to the heel side. That's a heel side seven for Harley. Well, he looked a little bit uncomfortable there, but it's the way he always seems to do it. He's so solid on that trick. And there's a toe side nine. He's putting in the big tricks now. Is Harley Clifford. Can the champion do it? As he edges in, he's really getting technical and he's getting absolutely huge too. Is Harley Clifford. And one more throw of the dice before the wild card. He's really trying to make sure that every single point counts as he squeezes one last trick in. And Harley Clifford now, the Mastercraft, will spin at the bottom end of the course and he'll be back for his wild card trick. So here he comes. What's it going to be? It's going to be something big, believe you me, as Harley edges in. And it's a big move five from Harley Clifford. Well, a pump of the fist. Will it be enough for Harley Clifford?
Clifford finishes the run with mixed emotions. He's not happy with the last pass and feels he might have blown the title, leaving Shota in the box seat. There's a delay with Clifford's score as the judges confer.
I didn't really do everything that I really wanted to get done out there, but like I said, it goes, probably ended up with a second, but all right. What do I just got done, I just realized I missed that really a trick that I should have done. It's actually pretty easy, so I mean, we'll say the results haven't come yet, but.
In the end, it was Clifford who took the title, but only by the narrowest of margins ahead of Shota in second. Despite the pressure, he continues to excel at the highest level, displaying a level of maturity well beyond his years.
This is my third action sports win in a row at Mandurah, so pretty stoked on that. I got the hat trick, so I'm pretty pumped on that. And I think I've won every World Cup the past like 3 years now, so pretty stoked on that, and I hope to just keep it going.
Well, what an exciting week of action we've had here in Mandurah in Western Australia. So many outstanding champions across so many sporting disciplines, and to the victors go the spoils. The EYRES Action Sports Games has been a great success, with huge crowds on hand to greet their sporting heroes and to take in the spectacle, with Mandurah providing the perfect backdrop to this world-class sporting event. I hope you've enjoyed all the color and excitement from the EYRES Action Sports Games here in Mandurah, Western Australia. Until next time, it's bye for now.